thank you very much. And you settled down for a nice snooze after lunch. I'm sorry to interrupt it. The question that you might very well ask is, why are you in this session? Which might be very well be the right question. And why am I speaking? Which is another question which is also interesting. So I would start off my talk by, why would you want to do a study? Right? And it's something which a lot of residents are very keen to ask, that why am I wasting my time? Well, some of you have to do a study. You don't have a choice in the matter. You ain't getting out of your degree course unless you do one. A lot of you would have to improve your CV. You know, I thought it was effective, and you know, to rack up publications when you go for job interviews abroad, you go for scholarships. People count the numbers, and that's pretty important. A lot of people do research for academic arrogance. You know, I publish in Lancet, and that chap just got into the Mongolian Journal of Surgery. You know, I'm a great person. But on the other hand, you might actually have interest in the subject that you are practicing, and some of us do. And you might have a genuine question which a study can answer. And if that is the case, then it is important to do your study properly. Right? So why should you do a study properly? If your study is properly done, it is more publishable, it's easier to write, it will go to a better journal, you'll have more exposure to that. It is also gratifying because you have actually answered the question, however trivial it might be. So that brings us to the next question. Why are some projects bad? The reason is that enough thought has not been given at the beginning. If you do a research project, it is exceedingly difficult to change at the halfway mark. So any effort that you spend at the beginning is never wasted. And the first step is to get your hypothesis, which is the research question, which we'll be discussing in the next 19 minutes. Right? So, you know, often people tend to get bored after lunch, so I've taken a topic of interest to everybody, which is cricket. So here you have a question, or I have a statement, this is my hypothesis, that Virat Kohli is better than Steve Smith. Right? So most Indians would agree with this, but I don't know whether Dr. Pandey, are you Australian, sir? Or he might very well say that Steve Smith is a far superior batsman. There's no doubt about that. But is this a good question? So surely you mean that he's a better batsman. We are scientific people. So we need to define what we are looking at. So you don't mean that his hairstyle is better, he's better in the ads. You mean that he's a better batsman. So we'll have to say it very specifically when we are designing the research question. Now, batsmen can be one day, 2020, it can be test match. So you might want to be a little more specific in what you're looking at. So you might want to make the statement that, let me focus, I don't have the resources to do everything. So let me say that he's a better test match batsman than Steve Smith. And better is a word which is very difficult to define. You know, it's like happiness. How do you define it? So one would need to have objective criteria to see what is better. And that would also be included in the research question. So I've just put down a list of things which might make it better. So match winning scores, or strike rate, or a batting average, or 100 scored, or matches won when you're playing and you made runs. So all these would be your endpoints. And this would be part of your research question. So you can choose one, which would be your primary endpoint, and that would be in your research question. And the rest you can keep as the secondary endpoints because you think that those are important, but not the most important thing, which will tell you that Kohli is a better batsman than Steve Smith. Now, these are called endpoints, and you're analyzing them at the end of your study. You have to determine them at the beginning of your study, right? And the reason for that is very obvious, that if you know what has happened, now supposing you want to say Gavaskar is better than Bradman, then I would say, well, you just choose the number of 100 scored. You want to say Bradman is better than Gavaskar, you just choose the batting average. Because at the end of the period of analysis, you already know the answers. So if you choose your endpoint at the end, that is not going to be valid because that's going to introduce your bias. So the way you'd usually do a thesis, that you gather the data, now let's see where I get a p-value, is not a great way to do a research question. If you honestly want to answer the question, you need to determine your endpoints in a prospective manner before you gather or analyze the data. This is a very informal talk. If any of you have any doubts, questions, objections, please raise your hands or yell or whatever you'd like to do, right? So this is the other phrase that you will come to when the research question is being discussed, which is the null hypothesis, which means there is no difference between A and B. So there's no difference between Coley and Steve Smith. And you disprove the null hypothesis to get a significant result. So that's a very straightforward and easy thing to understand. So obviously, Professor Shani would not be very happy if I just stayed on cricket and didn't get to the clinical point. So a good way to look at a research question for you is this acronym, which is PICO. Patient, intervention, comparator, outcome, and time frame, right? So that's a very straightforward thing. So now, again, I would pose a question. What is the best treatment for primary liver cancer in a cirrhotic patient? Very relevant question, relevant to all our practice. And is it radiofrequency ablation? If you ask interventional radiologists, they'll tell you nothing beats radiofrequency ablation. Anything can be ablated. But that's not really what we are setting. So let us refine this question the way we would refine the cricket question. So patient, in patients with Child's A cirrhosis with a solitary liver tumor less than 5 centimeters in size, intervention is radiofrequency ablation, better than surgery in prolonging my endpoint or the outcome, which is survival. And I'm not talking about a 1 year or 2 year survival, because that may not be meaningful for the patient. So let us take a significant amount of time over 5 years. Now, as you noticed, I have highlighted certain things. So this would depend on this, right? So if I were to just change Child's A to Child's B, I would not want to compare that with surgery, because you'll find that if you're operating on a lot of Child's B cirrhotics, they tend to die like flies. You're not going to get a happy time with the 5 year survival. And therefore, you might want the comparator to be something a little broader, which is more useful for a Child's B cirrhotic for someone within Milan's criteria, which would be a liver transplant. So your question would alter depending on the patient population that you would study. Similarly, the outcome that you're looking at would also depend on the question that you're framing. So for a solitary liver tumor less than 5 centimeters, is radiofrequency ablation better than chemoembolization in limiting tumor growth to liver transplant? So you have changed your endpoint in this study to what will bridge me to a liver transplant, right? Therefore, you change the comparator to chemoembolization, and the outcome you're interested at is not survival, because in the 6 months or 1 year, you wouldn't expect a significant mortality because of a 5 centimeter tumor in a Child's B cirrhotic because of the tumor. Therefore, you're talking about limiting tumor growth as tumor size as your main outcome when you're talking about this group of patients. So this just explains how you'd use PICO to frame a good research question, how you have to be very specific, and how everything depends on each other: the patient, the intervention, the comparator, the outcome, and the time frame. And you need to give it good thought before you begin your study. So where do you go wrong? So this is the standard thesis: a study of features of amoebic liver abscess. I think they're about, in the KM hospital library, there are probably 30 theses which all are titled features of amoebic liver abscess, and probably 29th is copied from 28th and down the line. So that's the way it works. So it's very good if you want to get a quick thesis out, but that's not really going to help you answer a question because it is exceedingly vague, right? The others is, now this was something which was in vogue when I was a resident, and this paper stuck in my mind. So they murdered a lot of mice. They gave them Lexi-Parfan before, and in 24 hours, they induced pancreatitis by injecting ethanol in the pancreas of mice, right? So do you think that this is a good question? Right? So I was wondering that, you know, when the patient comes to me with gallstone pancreatitis, it's not that, madam, tomorrow you're going to get gallstone pancreatitis. Would you like to have an injection of Lexi-Parfan today? It doesn't really work that way. So what is the relevance of preventing it 24 hours in advance with an injection when the event you are studying is not a predictable event? So the only pancreatitis you can study this way would be a post-ERCP pancreatitis, because that's the only one where it is in your hands to induce the pancreatitis and the time frame is fixed. And you know of all the studies on diclofenac and Lexi-Parfan in pancreatitis post-ERCP. But certainly all these mice have died in vain, and Menaka Gandhi would be perfectly happy to object to all this. So the way you would look at this is the so what question. So what if you can give Lexi-Parfan 24 hours to prevent pancreatitis? It is not going to be useful. So the so what question should be fulfilled. If someone asks you, so what? You should be able to answer that convincingly for your research question. The next can be obscure. This is another genuine study which has been done, that hamsters can catch colds from humans. Who cares? Right? So does it really matter? So the second question which is important for your research question is the who cares question. If someone asks you, is RFA better than chemoembolization? Somebody cares, right? If someone asks you, is Virat Kohli better than Steve Smith? The whole country cares. So you have to answer the so what and the who cares, so you know that your research question is something that is worth answering. You can be too ambitious. So I've just put in two projects here. Study of the human genome. It's been done. And the first time it was done, I think the Sanger Institute spent several billion dollars doing it. Your hospital research committee may not give you that sort of grant if you want to pursue this project. The second is effect of aspirin on colon cancer. It's a worthwhile study. Tata is doing the ad aspirin study at the moment. But the results will come in 12 years' time. So you need to know that your MS or your MCH is going to last for 12 years to get this outcome. So you may not want this as your research study if you're going to be in the institute for 3 years or 4 years. It's all right if you're tenured in the institute, because you either will have no money or no time to do this. So please look at your resources. The most important resources are time, money, and subjects on which you're going to do your study, right? So the third point where you can go wrong is you have underestimated the resources that you require for your research question. And the fourth goes without saying, no understanding of illness or techniques. And we are often tempted by complex laboratory techniques and, you know, PCR and ELISA and HLA. And we don't understand that as surgeons. So if you don't understand it, make sure you sit with someone who does, get it explained to you, because there are many, many shortcomings. For example, we did a study on thrombophilia states, and we're getting very peculiar results in the first 5 patients. So I said, why is this happening? No, this is really not supposed to be this way. Then we realized that we're storing the samples for 3 months and pooling them, because the kit would do 20 samples at a go and the lab didn't want to waste the kit. Now, the moment you freeze a blood sample and do a functional test like a thrombophilia study, you're going to get the wrong result. So we actually sat and studied how long can you preserve a sample before the value goes down. And we found out that for protein C and protein S, if you kept the sample for more than 6 weeks, the results would be invalid. So every 6 weeks you had to sit, whether you had 4 samples or 6 samples, you had to open your 20 sample kit and finish it off. So you need to understand the illness and you need to understand the techniques before you have an accurate research question fail. So knowledge is always the key. So how do you identify a good question? I've told you everything that's bad about it. So a good question identifies lacuna in current knowledge. There's no point being the 45th person to discover America. It's already been done. It can be answered by you in a measurable manner. So you have all the facilities to answer it. Not only that, it is not a subjective measurement like good, bad, better, worse. You have outcome measures like a survival, or a creatinine level or a hemoglobin level or a tumor size. There's something that you can measure so that statistics can be applied to it and it can be objectified. And it provides an answer, and that answer should not be further studies are required. Nothing would irritate a journal editor more than finding this line at the end of your paper, further studies are required. Then you might as well do the further studies and then proceed. Why have you stopped at this point? So this would be identifying a good question. And if you identify a good question, it's very easy to actually design the study. So I can actually finish Dr. Karte's talk here. So lacuna and current knowledge is the introduction. The way it can be answered by you is the method. The measurable manner is the results and the analysis. And the answer you provide is the conclusion. So I would conclude at that point. And if there are any questions, we have 5 minutes for a discussion. You know, there are many senior faculty here. They might, you know, as they usually do, that whatever Sudeep says is wrong, you know, we are happy to hear that. Any of you have any questions, more than happy to hear that as well. Yep. So I have 5 minutes left for any discussions. It's total silence. I mean, sir. Okay. Right, sir. So, at the resident trial, the easiest study to do is what your boss has interest in. So there's always something ongoing in your department. So your boss might be a fanatic about CA gallbladder. The boss might be interested in transplanting everyone with hepatocellular cancer. You know, so whatever your boss is interested in, you have a big resource. So as I mentioned, the key is to have the resource and the knowledge with you. So as long as you can frame a question around that which answers the so what, who cares, you will have a good study on board. Would that answer your question, sir? Yeah. Sir?
So Sudeep, just to say that, you know, at the level of a resident, you often don't know what to do.
Absolutely.
You don't know what is who, what, and what is who cares.
Yeah, which is why you're there, sir.
So, and sometimes there isn't somebody to tell you so what and who cares.
Right.
So then, to my mind, the best thing to do is to continue to gather your data.
Absolutely.
Keep records of everything that you do.
Right.
And at the end of some period of time, you will automatically find something to answer.
Right. So I would contradict Professor Shani there. You don't mind, sir, if I contradict
Absolutely.
You totally. Because I think this is the wrong way to go about it. Because retrospectively, whatever you do will always have lacunae.
Absolutely. I agree with you. But
I worked with someone called Professor Mathur. He's a legendary man. I don't know any of you had the chance to meet him or listen to him. So he had a portal hypertension proforma, right? It took him 5 years to refine the proforma. Computers had just been installed in the Department of Surgery when I was a resident. So the part of the life where I was not working, when I should actually be sleeping and having dinner, I was sitting in the department entering on what was called Lotus 123 in those days, all that data. And that data had 840 columns, because that is how much that proforma had to capture every bit of information. And that was 5 years work by a man who had dedicated his life to portal hypertension. As a resident, I don't think it's easy to have the maturity to capture all the data. At the most, you will capture cholecystectomy done, liver resection done, patient died, patient went home, tumor size was this. But that is not going to make for a unique question to be answered. So your best studies are always prospective. So you can use the audit to get an idea that this is worth looking at. And once you know it's worth looking at, make a detailed pro forma, run it past 3 people. Your friends will always be your best critics. You all know that. They're always happy to say you're wrong and to criticize you. So they will tell you that this and this and this is wrong with what you're doing. So you can keep improving and refining it over 6 months. And you'll have a year or two in which to gather that data prospectively. And that will give you a paper. So I think we would disagree with...
So I'm not suggesting for a moment that that's all that you should do with your life.
Absolutely.
So you should start with gathering data.
Yeah. So that is a very good way to get the ideas.
Correct. That's all.
Absolutely.
That's all.
Absolutely. So none of the bursary gentlemen have any questions. You shouldn't pay them unless they ask 2 questions per session. Yeah. Thank you.
Good afternoon to everybody. Dr. Sudeep has covered a lot of things for me. I can rush forward. In the study designs, I'll be just giving you a brief overview of designs, more so of randomized controlled trial. And at the end, I'll just show some slides about how to choose a design. Now, when it comes to study design, everybody knows that it should be simple and clear. As the previous lecture, such simple format he made for to understand very well what is a research question, which can become a very complex lecture. This is what study design means. Overall strategy chosen to logically assimilate the different study components what we have in a study so as to effectively address the research question. What is extremely important, which was emphasized just now, is to determine the research question, understand it very well, and then plan the study design. And it should not be the reverse way around, that you are good at doing a randomized controlled trial, so you will find our research question which will fulfill an RCT, and then you'll be doing it. Now, can anybody tell me, especially the bursary residents, what is so special about this picture, which again has been emphasized very clearly in the previous lecture? Anybody? It's a very, very famous picture. This is a reference for each and every newspaper in the world. Who is the gentleman there and what is he showing? Yes, that's the answer. Basically, what happened was, this is Chicago Daily Tribune, which is called as Chicago Tribune now. They required few hours to print the paper. And the election results, they had those projected results, they showed that DV will defeat Truman. And that's what they did, and they published. This is the only headline in the world which is totally wrong. So this was in 1948. And this is a reference. As I said, it's a headline in a big newspaper, and all Tribune newspapers, Washington Tribune, Chicago Tribune, and all the prominent Tribune newspapers have this framed in their publishing office, that this should never ever happen. And that was emphasized, that you should never ever plan a methodology or research design which is not correct, because everything, if you see IMRAD pattern, introduction, methods, results, and conclusion, and discussion, and then following that conclusion. If you get it from a reviewer, please change this results. You can change it. Do the table like this, do the table like that, you can do it. See, discussion is too long, too short, you're not covered, this reference, that covered, you can do it. But if he says this methodology is wrong, you have to do it again. The only way you can do it is go back and do the research of 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, whatever you have done, again. That is impossible. That is what happened here. They published it. Something, once the paper was released, nothing could be undone. So that is what it means by that. This is what it says: scientific integrity of the study and the credibility of study data, the results, depends substantially on study design. So it's extremely important to choose a study design, and not many designs are there. You don't have to learn very complex designs. And essentially, you should know exactly what should be good for a particular research question which you have chosen. Now, these are levels of evidence. All of you are aware what it means by that, and everybody would like to do this. A randomized controlled trial sits on the top, least bias. But sometimes a cohort study might be necessary to answer the question. Sometimes the case control studies can answer the question. And if you see the first case report treatment for GIST published as a single report in New England Journal of Medicine was the treatment of GIST by tyrosine kinase inhibitor. That was the first treatment of a solid organ tumor by treatment for that. So that is what I'm saying. If you have a case report also, you can have it in any JAM, and that is what is the importance of this. So every type of research design is important. Every type of research study is important, provided it is giving a relevant message. Now, this has been again emphasized, that if you have a good content, everything has been designed properly, novelty is there in your study, even if the style of writing is not so good, it's average, good chance of publication. Average content, average style, may be published. Content is not good. The design is totally wrong. Methodology is wrong. You might have written a very nice paper. Might have no grammatical errors, nice references quoted, everything, and everything is in style. It will not get accepted. Briefly, what are the study designs? Basic studies, not touch upon that. Observational studies, descriptive and analytical studies. And then you have the RCTs, clinical trials or field trials. Now, this is a standard thing. Wherever if you open study design, even if you open Google, you get a picture. and this will be having most of the things of the study design. So if you see broadly here, observational, interventional. If there is no interventional, it will be categorized as observation. If it is observation, there is a comparison arm, control, analytical study. There is no comparison arm, it will go into descriptive. Descriptive will be case report, case series, number of cases, cross-sectional. Cross-sectional, if it has control arm, it will go somewhere here. There is one more study which I have not put here, which can be an observational, can be interventional, and that is in the form of a diagnostic study. That I'll tell a little later. This is where you stand. Again, this is a very common picture. Where do you stand? What do you mean by a case control study? In short, you stand here. This is the investigator. You have the outcome. You go back and look at the exposure. This is one of the commonest studies submitted to IASG for paper presentation. A retrospective case series, go back, 120 patients, 500 patients, 1000 patients, 1500 patients, you will have cases and controls there, and then you try to find out the risk factors. Prospective cohort study, then you have a retrospective cohort study. I'll tell a little later on what you mean, because cohort people always think longitudinal studies are always in the prospective domain, but not always. Then you have something called cross-sectional study, the prevalence studies, where you have the exposure and the outcome at the same point. And then you, of course, have something similar to this, the RCT design. So this is along the time. Now, coming to observational studies, in short, researcher just describes the situation or event, pursues answers to who, what, when, where, and how. Descriptive studies, single group, may include case reports, case series, cross-sectional, and longitudinal study. So this is just few examples I'll give on based on a publication experience. Now you look at this. This is a retrospective case series of 109 cases of corrosive injuries of the stomach. What information you can get from this, which is extremely useful, is it is over a long period of time. You can see what type of strictures we get. Type 1 strictures, ring-like, prepyloric, 91%. So if anybody else does this sort of series over another length of time, more chances are there, likelihood you may get similar type of data. Minor variations could be there, but you have this sort of information. Now, this sort of information is very good in clinical practice for further treatment. Another picture, another of a study, you can see there, 30-year study. What information you can have from this? See, these are all descriptive studies. This is a non-analytical study, and you can see this. This is an information-based study to feed information into the literature, but extremely important because this can even help you in generating a flowchart for the management. You can see all these things. This has been done. So this will be readily accepted. This will be readily taken up by the journals because this information is a lacuna presently in the literature. It might not be an absolute lacuna, but a relative lacuna because very few studies are there from that domain, from that region, from that country on this type of thing. These are prevalence studies, descriptive. If you have a control arm, it can go into analytical type. Exposure and outcome at the same point of time you see. What is the prevalence of something, something, something in a cross-section population? Temporal relationship you cannot get from this. So this is a study said 20 years back. This was one of the first studies in India published about prevalence of Helicobacter pylori infection. And what is this? Just a prevalence study of H. pylori in upper GI disorders. It might look such a simple study, but there was no study prior to this in India about the prevalence of H. pylori infection in different disorders. So you have this information. Although we call it as a control arm, this was in asymptomatic people. So you say this is what it is. So somebody wants to know, if somebody talks, what is the prevalence of H. pylori in an asymptomatic population? So if you have 5-6 studies like that, you can give an answer to that. Little bit about analytical studies. These are again observational studies aimed to test the hypothesis generated by descriptive studies. Descriptive studies, you have got some information, you add on to it by observational studies. Superior, of course, because you're doing it later, control arm. Now, sometimes somebody says that you have done this sort of studies and this is what is my result. Then I ask you, are you sure this is a result what you have got in this study is a real result? Have you seen it in the normal population controls whether the same thing doesn't happen? The person says, I have not checked it. Then how can it be dogmatic? It says that A is superior to B because you have not checked it in the control arm. So that's why this study becomes a superior because you already have a control arm to show that in controls you don't get A better than B. Similar to retrospective case series, but with addition of control group, patients with disease outcome, you have the outcome and then you check. As I said, this is one of the commonest studies submitted to our thing and it has got a lot of data and information which is based on a prospectively maintained database. You may have 500 patients, you may have 1000 patients, you may have 1500 patients. It gives it generates so much of information that the people who are doing 20, 30, 40 cases, they have to refer to these studies to get the further guidance for clinical management. This is just an example what we are given, not a great study, but just to see the food pattern, whether it has got the dietary risk factors in colorectal carcinoma. So this is what we found, that if you see this adjusted OR, that means independent risk factor, that some of these items what I mentioned there, that they could be the risk factors for colorectal carcinoma. Now, colorectal carcinoma is existing for a long time. Food is a food, everybody takes food, the dietary pattern is existing, but unless and until you do a study this type, you don't have a documentation. You may say this produces that, when in our population, do you have a documentation of that? So that is what is the importance of the studies, which are, this is like a case control study. We get the odds ratio. If you see that, this is what is OR. Basically, in case control studies, you have the outcome, you have colorectal carcinoma, people who don't have, people who have. What are the risk factors which are present in a higher proportion in patients who are having risk? That is what we like to see. That is what we see by calculations. There is something where when you're doing a case control study, if you take two groups, a lot of covariables could be there. So can you do a case control study design in which the other covariables are controlled? Now it's a retrospective design, so you may not be able to control, but this is one of the ways we can do that. We have seen the estrogen and progesterone receptors in patients with esophageal carcinoma, and the controls were the normal esophagus in that patient. We took the distance away from the lesion and then took and studied the estrogen receptor status to find out whether it is higher, lower, what is the comparison. So all the other parameters, same patient, they got adjusted. And you have only the variable of estrogen receptors, which is different. This is one of the studies which might be a problem at the resident level, because many of the factors in a cohort study or a longitudinal study, what happens is it requires time. So sometimes it becomes difficult because of the stipulated time of maybe 18 months, 2 years, because ethics committee clearance and all those things. You may not have adequate time to do that study. But this is, of course, a study which has got its own importance. You can control the confounding variables. It's in the prospective nature. And location, it's slightly different from RCT. Location is not controlled by the researcher and you don't randomize and there's no intervention. There can be something called as a historical cohort study. I told you the retrospective design also is there. I'll tell you a little later what you mean by that. Now, these are the advantages of a cohort study. Disadvantages are larger number needed, longer time required. That's the main problem with a cohort study, but definitely it has advantages. And when we talk of a case control study, we check out the OR, that is the odds ratio. When we are doing a cohort study, we see the relative risk, RR, what is the chance of a relative risk of getting the disease or the problem. Now, just an example of cohort study. You have patients, a cohort of phrase procedure, and we try to study here what happens to the islet cell function in these patients following surgery in patients of chronic calcific pancreatitis. So you can see here, in this cohort study, what we found out, these are the things, this is the difference, pre-surgery, post-surgery. So you get information. Now here what happens is, it is possible to do within limited time because you have the cohort of phrase procedure. Many departments are involved who are doing the procedure, so you have a good number. That's an advantage of taking a multidisciplinary, multi-hospital study. Sometimes you have to do, sometimes multi-country study also you have to do. So you have the cohort, then you do the, you get the population, then you follow it up, and this sort of intervention which you are analyzing and checking doesn't require much of time. This is one of the retrospective cohort. I wanted to give you an example where this long time back we had published. It had a randomized controlled trial in the prospective component. You can see that something very unique type of study published in British Journal of Surgery. And it had a retrospective component. You can see here, this is the retrospective component, what we saw. Not working now. You can see lower down, the retrospective component. We saw, we took the patients who were exposed to H. pylori 5 years back, and whether they operated 5 years back for ulcer, perforated duodenal ulcer, whether presently they have got association of H. pylori and ulcer disease. So that is what we wanted to see. So we had a small component there, additionally to the prospective component. This is a separate study design, not fitting into a typical interventional or observational design, and that is the study design assessing a diagnostic accuracy. This is a very, very important design because a lot of tests we do, sometimes procedures we do, interventional procedures we do, and we'd like to know what is the diagnostic accuracy of that procedure. So this is where the classical way we check is sensitivity specificity, PPV, NPV, and likelihood we don't see that often. Sometimes for continuous variables, you have to use a ROC, that is the area under curve. In this study, what is extremely important, whenever anybody is undertaking a study for diagnostic design, the gold standard has to be defined in the literature. If you don't design the gold standard properly and the reviewer says what gold standard you have taken is not appropriate, then the study is gone. So that's why it's extremely important. That's the most important part as far as this study is concerned. And then, of course, you should define what is positive by the test, what is negative, and what is indeterminate, and what you are going to do with the indeterminate type of test for calculation. Just an example, this is about a new test we performed and tested, and this is how you'll get the results. Now, coming to interventional studies, non-randomized controlled trials, not commonly done. If you can do an interventional study, then why not do a randomized controlled trial? So I'll not speak on that. Field trials doesn't come much into our purview. So I'll stick on to the classical randomized controlled trials. I'll not speak on this slide. Everybody knows what is it. Advantages, randomization, blinding, and attrition also is covered in this, the dropout rate. Now, sometimes I ask somebody, are you doing a randomized controlled trial? They think that because it has got a control arm, you call it as a controlled trial. That's not correct. That's a misnomer. Controlled trial means these are things we control. Eligibility criteria, specified hypothesis, most important is stopping rules. That also you have to predefine, and then, of course, monitoring. Different type of design. The first design only, mostly it is done. Parallel arm trials, you have a control arm, the standard of care, and the new arm, which is the interventional arm. Rarely equivalence trials, but both the arms are having intervention. Of course, crossover design, surgical side, and most of the times it is not possible. Medical side possible. Factorial designs are not commonly used. Now, last few years, we are doing this superiority trials. Now, presently, one of our students was sitting in a hall. She's doing a non-inferiority randomized controlled trial. Whenever you are comparing complications of a new procedure is you feel is better than the existing procedure, but it should not lead to complications more than the existing procedure. That is the time you do a non-inferiority trial. You prove that it is equivalent to that, and if it is equivalent to that, because the procedure is better, I'd like to prefer that. And superiority trial, of course, you try to prove this is superior. This has already been covered. PICO, what you call, and add the time frame to that. Just an example of PICO. This actually in an RCT is very important. When you write the aims and objectives, the PICO should come into aims and objectives. PICO. Many times it should come into, people will say, into the title, but title it's not necessary. But aims and objectives must have to make it very specific. You have to mention what is intervention, you have to mention what is control, the patient population, and the outcome. Methods, of course, it has been again stressed. Something which cannot be reversed. So you have to have a proper design, setting, patient, study procedure. Primary and secondary outcomes have to be defined very properly. You can see here on the right-hand side, top outcome measures are defined very clearly. Without that, you cannot do the sample size calculation also, and without that, you cannot tell exactly what you are doing, what you want to get out from the study. That is what it means by the research question. Research question is broad-based aim, and then you put the objectives below that. Primary endpoint, secondary endpoint, all the details have to be told. In an RCT, eligibility and enrollment has to be first predefined, and then this is sometimes people get confused. Are you blinding? Allocation concealment. Allocation concealment is practically, not practically, always should be done for all randomized controlled trials. What you call it as nose. Okay, the opaque envelope and all that is what is allocation. Blinding is totally different. Blinding may or may not be done in all RCTs. A blinded RCT, of course, is superior, but blinding is important when your objectives are going to be subjective. If you have a very objective component in the objectives, you may not require blinding. That objective component means you are assessing mortality. Now, mortality, there cannot be any bias. Either patient is dead or alive. If that is one of the important endpoints, then it need not be a blinded study. But if you have something like pain, if you have something which is a little vague, and the observer also cannot interpret properly, and the patient also cannot tell properly, then it definitely becomes important to have blinding in the study. Allocation concealment, this is what it means, and then the different types of randomization. Just one or two lines I'll mention here, that many times when we do a RCT, we think that you have got 100 patients, your plan is for 100, 50, 50 in each arms. As far as possible, you should not do simple randomization. Always try to do block randomization. It's not at all difficult to do a block randomization, because suppose you have made blocks and the block is of 10, you have finished, you could not manage 100 patients for some reason and you are stopped at 80. So at least you will have a block, say 82 patients you have finished. You will have a block which is not very much unequal. If you have a block of 4 and 6, it will definitely have a difference of 2 or 3. But theoretically, it can happen that if you have taken a block of 100 and you land up with 75 patients, all 25 could be in one arm and all 15 other arm. So you have a gross disproportionate number of patients distributed. You cannot do analysis with that sort of thing. So that is what it means by that. Permitted block, you can read about it and what do you mean by stratified randomized. Not commonly used, but permitted is the numbers. What I'm telling you, have unequal size blocks. This is what I said about blinding. As far as possible, if it is possible, you should be able to do, and if it is necessary, you should do it. Otherwise, blinding may not be a component of randomized controlled trials always. This is another important point, sample size calculation. Should be very clear. First of all, sample size calculation is, study is usually not powered for secondary endpoints. So there should be a difference between primary endpoint and secondary endpoint. So primary endpoint is the primary outcome you are looking from the study. You may have one, you may have two, you may have three. You may take a composite outcome also, primary outcome. But the sample size calculation should be such that it will be powering that primary outcome. Powering means if you find a difference, it's actually the difference what you are seeing there. Otherwise, you are committing errors, which is called as type 1 or type 2 errors. Okay, I'll not go into details. So type 1 error, what we call is a p-value, alpha error. Type beta error is the type 2 error, which is the power of the study. Just to give an example, this is how usually you write the sample size calculation. The primary outcome was used for this thing. Here the LOH, length of hospitalization primary outcome, 45 in each arm. This is the thing, you have to prove a reference because the previous publication has showed this, how you have done the calculation. Dropout rate also is included in that. So if you have something like this, okay, there is no reason that the reviewer should have any question, any query in understanding your sample size calculation. This is a consort chart which has become mandatory, and since 2010 or 12 onwards, you have to do registration also for all clinical trials. Without registration, no trial will be published or accepted. And then this is all about the consort. Another important thing, what you have to plan, as Dr. Sudeep was telling, the resources, the number of patients. If you feel and the follow-up that you see the style in your hospital, if you are doing a study with a lot of follow-up loss, lot of attrition of patients is there, you might have done a calculation for statistical analysis and all that, that's different. But it will lead to something called as when you have to do ITT analysis, intention to treat analysis, you will not get a proper result. I'll just give you an example of that, something about per protocol and ITT analysis. This is one of the trials we published about 8-9 years back about two drug therapies. Now you can see here below, okay, this pointer is, this is not, now it's working. Now see here, this is what it is. Now see, 36 were included and this is called as per protocol analysis. 4 were excluded. So you see the eradication rate, 81%, because 26 were eradicated out of 32. So I have conveniently excluded whosoever did not come for follow-up. Only the people who came for follow-up have included. So what is the deficiency here? Maybe those fellows died. I have not taken any account. So ITT means like this. The denominator will be the number. The moment you are randomized, it is used for calculation. See the eradication rate. If you see the previous one, it is showing 81%. If you see the next one, it is showing 72%. 72% is very bad. This is what is ITT analysis. So all randomized controlled trials, they expect good ITT analysis. When the PP and ITT will be equal? Can anybody tell? The waking up question. When the follow-up loss is extremely minimal. So then the PP and ITT will be same. So that is why mostly prefer ITT analysis. So you should go for that. So you have to plan it such that your follow-up in your hospital setup is very, very less loss for follow-up is there. This is how you mention the results. You can see the primary and secondary outcomes are mentioned. This is the primary outcome and these are all the. In RCT, you will have a two-column table. This is the interventional arm and this is the control arm. CI also to mention better in the arm because confidence interval, so that you can actually talk about the p-value. Sometimes p-value is significant, but if the CI is not showing it properly, then it might not be a result which might be showing a proper significant difference. Results is what you get. No interpretation should be there. This is what I tell results, students, that if you want to write a story, write in the discussion part of it. You will not write it any, this has happened because of this, this happened because of this, this happened, nothing, no reasons have to be given. Whatever you have got, you have to write. Negative points also you have to write, and there should be absolutely no bias. Sometimes what happens is you write, this is 35%, that is 17%, and this 35% is more than 17%. Actually, p-value is 0.2. P-value is suggesting that there is no difference. There's no difference, whatever the reason for that is. Okay, when you get something like a difference like this, this happens because of low sample size. When you have a low sample size, what it is seen there is actually not there. So in those circumstances, you are committing a type 1 error. But because you ignore the p-value there, and then you say that this treatment was better than this. So this is what it should not be done. So you should not try to overinterpret, and you should tell exactly, I will answer it that both were similar. This is double, this is 35%, 17%. But I'll say it is similar because statistically it is showing no result. And then readers should be able to make the independent judgment, so you should not put biased results. These are checklists for RCT. All these things have to be done. I don't have to tell. Nowadays you have a good checklist from consort. Stopping rules, mandatory, should be followed, and this can only be done when you have trial monitoring. So you have an ethical committee, you have to intermittently present the trials, the progress in those circumstances. You can tell a little bit about how to choose an appropriate study design. That's not possible without having a good background of study designs. This is what is important. Assess the feasibility. The best design will be the least biased design, and that's a randomized controlled trial. But it's not possible to do every time. So you go down the order. What study is possible? Not possible. Come down to case control study? Not possible. Sometimes only a case series will have to do to get the result. This is how it is. Formulate research question design, and then RCT, then you see cohort study. This is what I told. Otherwise, only a case series will answer your thing. This I don't have to tell much. I've already been told how. So key points. Study designs in medical research can be broadly classified as these three. Observationals, descriptive and analytical. Case control study proceeds from outcome to exposure. You have the diagnosis with you and you're looking for the risk factors. Cohort is the reverse way. RCT is commonly parallel arm, crossover and factorial. We do mostly parallel arm designs. Okay. The keystone in decision-making process for suitable studies, reducing bias and increasing efficiency. That does not mean selecting a particular design always for your research question when it is not appropriate. So this is what is the last message. Although RCTs and control cohort studies provide higher level of evidence, the best study design is the one that answers the research question most explicitly in that for that particular research question. Just an example, can anybody tell what design would like to take for this? Yes? Yeah, prospective cohort study would be a good thing. So what you'd like to have patients of hepatitis B and no hepatitis B, follow them up, but HCC and liver cancer may develop 5 years, 10 years later. So that becomes a problem. Any other design? The next one will be cases and controls. Definitely a cohort study will be superior here, prospective cohort. Okay, but otherwise you'll have to rely upon cases and controls. So in those circumstances, you'll find out patients with hepatitis B, no hepatitis B, you have a large series, you have a patient with cancer, not hepatitis B, you have a cancer and no cancer, and see whether their hepatitis B is shown as a risk factor. How will you see that? What answer will you get in a case control study to tell that hepatitis B is a risk factor? Odds ratio will be higher for hepatitis B, independent, it's an independent risk factor for liver cancer. This one, let's say you have developed a robotic surgery for colonic cancer and you want to compare it to the existing laparoscopic surgery. Which study design? Yes, definitely you would like to do an RCT. It's possible, feasible, and it will give you the clear-cut answer with proper number of patients. And when you are doing an RCT, remember that you have just now started robotic surgery last month. You should not do like that. Because you are new for robotic surgery and you are doing a laparoscopic surgery for the same procedure for the last 10 years, definitely you will have biased results. So in those circumstances, there's something called as pilot. You can do a pilot, wait for some time, get the results, and then proper a definite planned study and a randomized controlled trial, or you can do a multi-center or multi-country trial if you want a large numbers to find out whether it is really beneficial. When will you require large numbers to find out the difference? When will you require the large numbers? You'll require the large numbers when you're not expecting to find a great deal of difference between the two. So that is the time if you see many of these acronym studies are multi-centric and multi-country, and they'll involve a lot of centers, and you require expertise also to do this procedure. Some of the books you published. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
So thank you for this opportunity. I think I'm at a disadvantage because I'm the only anesthesiologist in this room, but I happen to be married to a surgeon, so I understand the limitations in this crowd. So this is going to be the outline of my talk. We're going to start by looking at sample versus population, a little bit about descriptive statistics, statistical errors and p-value, odds, risk, hazard ratios, confidence intervals, and regression techniques. And then the last 15 minutes, I'd just like to go over what to look for in a paper. So starting with sample versus population, We would like to do studies in the entire population, but obviously that's not possible. So we choose samples from the population, and we assume that the results that we find in the sample will be the same as what we can expect in the population, right? So if I wanted to know the average height of everybody in the world who was 40 years old, obviously I couldn't do that. So maybe I choose a section of people either in this hospital or in this city or in this room who are 40 years old. I measure their height, and I assume that this average is going to correspond to that average, right? The problem is, depending on the sample that you take, your estimate may vary slightly from the true population estimate. And that is something you need to remember, that when we draw inferences from a sample, it is likely to differ slightly from what you would have found in the population. So you need to allow for that margin of error. So coming to descriptive statistics, broadly data can be divided into two types. And this is very important because at the end of your study, when you're analyzing your data, the kind of test that you will use will depend on what your data is and how you've measured it. Okay? So data broadly can be divided into categorical or qualitative data. This is data which answers the question, what type? Okay? It's something which can't be counted. So hair color, gender, survival or death, pain, mild, moderate, severe. All these are examples of qualitative or categorical data. On the other hand, numerical or quantitative data is data which can be counted. How many, how much, okay? For example, height, weight, blood pressure, hemoglobin, all of these are examples of numerical data. Pain, again, can be numerical data if you choose a numerical scale to measure it. So it's not hard and fast. If you choose to measure pain as mild, moderate, severe, it's categorical. If you choose to measure it on a numerical scale, it becomes quantitative. So when we summarize data, how do we do it, right? For categorical data, we talk about percentages or proportions. And for numerical data, if it's normally distributed, we talk about the mean and the standard deviation. For not normally distributed or skewed data or distribution-free data, we talk about the median with the interquartile range. So this is an example of normally distributed data. We all know about this. It's a bell-shaped curve where most of the readings lie around the center and then they taper off on either side. And there are certain fundamental principles about this kind of data, that the mean represents the average, the arithmetic mean represents the average, and the variability within this data is given by something called the standard deviation. So you always talk about mean with standard deviation. And if you were to look at the area under this curve, mean plus two standard deviations on either side occupies 95% of the area under this curve. Okay? So now if you know the mean of a particular sample and you know the standard deviation, you can predict that 95% of the readings in that sample would lie between the mean and two standard deviations on either side. As opposed to this, you have data which is skewed or distribution free. And here you can't talk about the mean because the mean doesn't represent the true average. Instead, for this kind of data, we arrange the data in either ascending order or descending order. And imagine theoretically, if you were to divide it into 100 equal parts, then the 50th centile or the 50th percentile, right? That is the median, okay? So it's the middle value. And we usually talk about the range, which means what is the smallest value and what is the largest value. You can see that in red over there. Or you can talk about what was the 25th centile and what was the 75th centile, which means 50% of your readings lay between the two blue arrows. That is what is known as the interquartile range. So this is an example of a study published in NAJM, which looked at pre-op biliary drainage for cancer of the head of pancreas. And you can see how they have summarized the baseline characteristics of the patients, okay? So age, because it's normally distributed, is mean plus standard deviation. Now, we tend to focus on the mean, but you need to remember that the standard deviation is 10, right? So 95% of the readings would have ranged 20 below this and 20 above this, which means 95% of patients were between 44 and 84 years of age, okay? because gender is categorical data, they've given you the number and the proportion or percentage over there. So 70% of patients were male. Because duration of symptoms was not normally distributed, they've spoken about the median and the interquartile range. I've circled this p-value in red. So they've given us p-values for the difference in baseline characteristics between the group. And I'll, at the end of my talk, I'll explain to you what the problem with that is. Are we okay so far? Yes? Yes, good. So now we come to inferential statistics. So far it is descriptive. You were just describing the group. You were talking about percentages, proportions, means, and medians. But now you want to draw inferences from the sample results. You want to compare the groups. You want to find treatment effects. You want to extrapolate to the population. And as I've reminded you, there is the possibility that you will make an error because your sample is not exactly your population. So this was a trial which looked at postoperative chewing gum versus standard care after colorectal resection. Okay, and they were looking at return of bowel movement and as the outcome. So look at this table very carefully. In reality, there are two possibilities, right? One is that chewing gum is no better than placebo. It's just equal to placebo, right? And the other is that chewing gum is better than placebo. Now, depending on your study findings, we can make certain errors. So suppose your study finds that chewing gum is no better than placebo, okay? And in reality, it is no better than placebo. This is fine because you have found the truth. On the other hand, if chewing gum is better than placebo and that is what your study found, that's also fine because again, you found the truth. Supposing in reality, there is no difference between the two treatments, but your study finds a difference. This is what we call a false positive error or a type 1 error. It's also known as an alpha error. Okay? Or if chewing gum is actually better than placebo, but your study doesn't find that difference. This is what we call a false negative error or a type 2 error or a beta error. Remember, this you will never know because this is in reality in the entire population, right? All you have are your study findings. And therefore, you need to design your study and calculate the sample size such that your type 1 and your type 2 errors are kept to a minimum, okay? So let's just go over type 1 and type 2 errors once again. A type 1 or alpha error for a superiority trial, okay, is finding a difference where a difference does not actually exist, okay? And it's conventionally set at 5%. What this means is that at the end of your study, if you find a difference between the two groups, you're 95% certain that this is a real difference, and there is only a 5% probability that this difference has occurred by chance. A type 2 or a beta error is not finding a difference where a difference actually exists. So there is a difference between two treatments, but the study has not picked up that difference. Okay? The power of the study is the converse of the beta error. It is 1 minus beta. So the power of the study is the ability to pick up a difference if the difference exists. And the power can be 80 or 90%, which means your beta error can be 20 or 10%. This means if there is a difference between two treatments, you're 80% or 90% sure that your study will pick it up. And there's only a 10 or 20% probability that it will get missed, that you'll get a falsely negative study. Please remember that all these definitions are with respect to superiority studies. There is another category of studies called non-inferiority studies where these definitions will change. So why are these errors important? Because we use them for sample size calculation. Okay, this was the same chewing gum study. You can see how they calculated the sample size. It's based on three things: alpha error, beta error, and the expected difference between the groups. Okay, so they used a 5% alpha error. They used an 84% power, and they expected to find a difference of 1.5 days. In the primary outcome, which I think was length of stay in hospital. Okay, so this is why it's important to know your alpha and your beta error, because that decides the sample size calculation. Now, alpha and beta are decided before you start the study, at the planning stage. At the end of the study, you get something called this p-value, right, which all of us are very fond of, p less than 0.05. So what does p actually mean? Okay, so in this study, length of hospital stay was 0.962 p-value. What does that mean? No, what does it mean exactly? Fantastic. Okay. So the P tells you what is the probability that the difference that you're seeing has occurred just by chance. Okay. So at the end of your study, when you run statistical tests, the p-value tells you what is the probability that if you're seeing a difference, that difference has occurred by chance. Now, in the first row, you're not really seeing a difference. But look at some of the others. 0.004. Okay, so what's this? Quality of life at 6 weeks. Okay, they found some difference and the p-value was 0.004. Okay, which means there's a 0.4% probability that this difference has occurred by chance. And there's it's 99.6% likely to be a real difference. Okay. Now, I am not getting into the nitty-gritty because there is a problem when you run multiple tests like this. You can get falsely positive results. That is the problem with multiple testing. But I'm just trying to explain to you the concept of p-value and what you need to understand from p-values. Okay. So remember, alpha is what we set as the acceptable limit for finding a difference by chance. Okay. And that's usually set at 5% for most trials. At the end of the study, the p-value tells us what is the probability that the difference we have seen has occurred by chance. So p needs to be interpreted in the context of alpha, right? If your alpha was 5%, your p has to be less than 5%. If your alpha was 1%, your p has to be less than 0.01. Odds and risk. Okay, coming back to the same paper. So this paper actually compared two groups. One group underwent surgery directly. The other group had preoperative biliary drainage prior to surgery. Okay, and those were the two arms and the outcome was major complications. When we talk about risk, okay, it's the likelihood of occurrence of an event in the population at risk. So in this group, which had BD plus surgery, you had 102 patients. And 75 had major complications. So the risk of complications is 75 divided by 102, which is 74%. It's very straightforward, right? Out of everybody who could have had a complication, how many had complications? In the surgery group, out of 94, 37 had complications. So again, out of everyone who could have had a complication, how many had a complication? So the risk of complications in this group was 74%. And the risk of complications in this group is 39%. Okay, so risk is something very easy to understand. Out of everybody at risk, how many had the event? Sometimes we talk about absolute risk reduction, which is also known as attributable risk reduction. It's nothing but the difference in risk between the two groups. So in this group, the risk is 74%. In this group, the risk is 39%. And therefore, the absolute risk reduction is 74 minus 39, which is 35%. So this new treatment, okay, is reducing the risk by an absolute amount of 35%. Yes? Now, this brings us to the next concept, number needed to treat or number needed to harm, depending on whether you're using a treatment for benefit or you're looking at an intervention which causes harm. Okay? So now, if 100 patients had biliary drainage, 74 will have complications, right? Now, the same 100, if instead of giving them biliary drainage, you did upfront surgery, only 39 will have complications, correct? So, by doing this procedure or by avoiding this procedure, you are preventing 35 patients from having complications, which means for every 100 patients treated with the new arm, you're saving 35, right? Yes, no, yes. And therefore, to save one patient, you would need to treat 100 divided by 35, that is 3. So for every 3 patients who receive the new treatment or do not receive the old treatment, okay, you will save 1, okay? And this is what we call the number needed to treat to prevent one event. Okay? Why is this important? It's important in health economics. If your intervention is very expensive, okay, you need to know how many people do you need to treat with that new intervention to get some benefit, and is it worth the investment? Okay? So look at this study. It's not related to your field, but it's a pretty nice example of NNT. So this was looking at transfusion-related adverse events in critically ill patients. Okay, so you want to avoid giving them allogenic transfusions. Instead, you give them recombinant human erythropoietin. Okay. Now, the problem with this is, if you wanted to prevent any transfusion-related event, you would have to treat 5,000 patients. And the cost of that would be so many dollars. Okay. If you wanted to prevent serious transfusion-related events, you would have to spend so many thousands of dollars just to stop transfusing and give erythropoietin. And so the conclusion was that from the perspective of avoidance of adverse events, because it's such a rare event and the number needed to treat is so large, it doesn't seem to be a cost-effective measure. Okay? So NNT is used mainly in cost-effectiveness studies when you want to decide whether a particular intervention is worth implementing. Now we come to the next concept, which is relative risk reduction. So relative to the baseline risk, how much are we reducing the risk with the new treatment, right? So we know that the baseline risk is 74%. Of that, you are removing 35% of the risk by this new treatment, right? So 35% of the baseline risk gets removed, which is a 47% relative risk reduction. Clear? Unclear? Not getting any feedback? Not clear. Right. So your baseline risk is 74% if you're using this treatment, right? When you implemented the new treatment, only surgery, you removed 35% of the risk. So how much of the baseline risk did you remove? 35 divided by 74, which is 47%. Okay? Why is this important? Can anyone think about why we need absolute risk reduction and relative risk reduction? Okay. So supposing a particular event, okay, had a risk of 90%. And I tell you there is a 5% absolute risk reduction. How much does the new risk come to? 80? 85, right? So 90 becomes 85. Okay. Supposing something has a risk of 10%, and I tell you there's a 5% absolute risk reduction. How much does that come to? 5%. So now when you're looking at 90 versus 85 and 10 versus 5, which do you think is a more significant relative risk reduction? Sorry? 10 to 5 is a 50% relative risk reduction, right? You're reducing the risk by 50%. 90 to 85 is a very, very small risk reduction. So which is why only absolute risk reduction doesn't give us enough information. You need to talk about the absolute risk reduction, but also explain how much of the baseline risk is getting removed. So relatively, how much is the risk reduction? Now, Dr. Kate used this term quite a bit in his talk, relative risk. It's also known as risk ratio, RR, right? What RR does is it compares the risk in one group with the other. So far, we've been subtracting risks, right? Absolute risk reduction is one minus the other. Now, we're starting to divide risks, okay? So now, the risk in this group is 74% and the risk in the other group is 39%. And so the risk in this group relative to that group is 74 by 39, which is almost 2. So the interpretation of this is that if you underwent this procedure, you have almost twice the risk of complications as if you underwent upfront surgery, right? So that is what relative risk means. What is the risk in one group compared to the risk in the other group? You could also divide it the other way around. I could divide 39 by 74 and say that the relative risk of complications in the surgery arm is half that of the biliary drainage arm. So it's two if you divide it this way, it's half if you divide it that way. It just depends on what you want to express it as. This brings us to another term called odds. Okay? And the reason we have this term is because for certain kinds of studies, case control studies specifically, you don't start with a group at risk. So it's not like you're starting with 100 smokers and seeing how many of them get lung cancer. You're starting with the outcome and then going back and determining the exposure. So in such studies, it is not possible to calculate risk. Okay, and you can only calculate something called the odds. Now, what exactly does the odds mean? The odds is the likelihood of occurrence of an event versus its non-occurrence. Okay, so please remember, risk and odds you can only talk about for binary data, data which has only two outcomes, death and survival, complication, no complication. Okay, you can only talk about risk and odds for binary or dichotomous data. So now in here, you have 102 patients who underwent this procedure. Of them, 75 had complications and 27 did not have complications. So now odds is 75 divided by 27, the probability of having a complication by not having a complication. It's not 75 divided by 102. Okay? And the odds in this case is 2.8. Okay? If you remember, the risk was 1 point something, right? Surgery alone, similarly, the odds is 37 by 57, okay? And the value is 0.6. Now, even if you don't remember how it's derived, just remember that odds is used in case control studies as a measure of association. Is there an increased likelihood of exposure in one group as compared to the other group? Okay? And just like we saw risk ratio, you can have an odds ratio. So you divide the odds in one group by the odds in the other group, okay, and you get an odds ratio. Okay, so the odds ratio for major complications in this arm versus this arm is 4.7. If you remember, the relative risk was 2, right? What this means is that patients in this arm are far more likely to have complications as compared to this arm. Or if you're looking at it backwards, as in a case control study, patients who have complications are far more likely to have undergone this procedure as compared to this procedure. Okay? Are we okay with odds and risk and odds ratio and relative risk? Yes, no? Interpretation of relative risk and odds ratio. An RR or OR of 1 indicates that there is no difference between the groups. Okay? If you have to understand it mathematically, just think you're dividing one by the other. So if something divided by something is 1, it means the two are equal, right? An RR or OR of less than 1 indicates a reduction in the risk or a reduction in the odds, okay? It means that person is less likely to have a complication or less likely to have a exposure to the arm which is causing complications. This signifies an effective treatment. An RR or OR of more than 1 indicates an increase in the risk or an increase in the odds. Okay? That means harm is increasing. It's an ineffective treatment. Okay? It's an inferior treatment. Just to summarize, for prospective studies, you could use either RR or OR. Okay? A lot of the statistical software, when you do your regression analysis, will by default give you an odds ratio even for prospective studies. Though the better word or better term to use would be relative risk. So you should convert it to relative risk wherever possible. For case control studies, only odds ratios are possible. You cannot do relative risks. Okay? For rare events, odds and risk are more or less similar and can be used interchangeably. Okay, so this is just an example of the same study. They've given you relative risks for various complications. Does anybody want to have a go at interpreting those relative risks? So for overall protocol specified complications, the relative risk was 0.54 in the surgery arm as compared to drainage arm. What does that mean?
patients in the surgery.
Is that what it means?
Half the risk of.
Yeah.
Half the risk of
development. Yeah. So, in the surgery arm, the risk of developing complications is 54% as compared to 100% in the other arm. So the other arm is your reference arm. If there the risk is 100%, here the risk is 54%, which means this is reducing your risk by 46%, right? So there's a 46% reduction in the risk. Did you get that? So a relative risk of 0.54 means relative to a risk of 1 in the reference group, right? So here, this is the reference group. Here, if you assume the risk is 1, that is 100%, then these risk ratios are for this group. For example, other complications, the risk is actually 1.3. What does that mean? What does a risk of 1.3 mean, a relative risk of 1.3? 27 minutes. Yes, your surgery arm is actually increasing the risk of other complications by 30% as compared to the pre-op BD arm, okay, and so on. Okay. And so this brings us to the next concept, that is confidence intervals, okay? So we already spoke about how the sample gives us one result, right? The sample gave you a relative risk of 0.54 or a relative risk of 1.3. But now you're interested in knowing what kind of values can I expect in the population? We spoke about errors and we know that this result will not be identical in the population, right? So basically, we use these sample results and we use something called a standard error. And we calculate a range of values for the population, okay? And these are known as the confidence intervals for that particular sample statistic. So if you have a relative risk, then you will have confidence intervals for the relative risk. If you have a sample mean, you'll have confidence intervals for the sample mean. And what we're trying to say is, this is my sample mean, but I'm 95% confident that the true population value will lie between these two values, okay? So let's just look at that. In this study, it was 0.54, but the 95% confidence intervals for this are 0.41 to 0.71, okay? What this means is that you can be 95% confident that the relative risk in the population will range from 0.41 to 0.71. Can anybody interpret that for me? Superb. Superb. Okay. So this means in the population, this arm, the surgery arm, will reduce the risk by as little as 30% or as much as 60%. Okay. But you're 95% sure that there is a reduction. Okay. The magnitude of the reduction will vary from 30% to 60%. Okay. Can we do this for one more? Look at this. Other complications. We saw that the population, the sample value was 1.3 and the confidence intervals are 0.8 to 2. What does that mean? Yeah. So this means that in the population, in this study, it increased the risk by 30%, right? In the population, you can be 95% confident that surgery will either decrease the risk by 20% or actually double the risk, okay? So this is a wide confidence interval. Is there something else peculiar about this confidence interval? Is it including some value? It's including the value 1. Which means in the population, there is a possibility that there is no difference between the groups. So when your 95% confidence intervals for an odds ratio or a risk ratio include the value 1, you know that that result is not statistically significant. Okay? To be statistically significant, your confidence intervals have to lie on the same side of 1, either less than 1 or more than 1. So This is a statistically significant result. If this result, instead of being 0.83 to 2.4, had been 1.1 to 2.0, okay, that would have been a statistically significant result. So for odds, ratios, and relative risk, remember, if the confidence intervals include unity, it means the result is not statistically significant. Just like you have confidence intervals for relative risk and odds ratio, you can have confidence interval for any sample statistic. So here they've compared two proportions, right? How many patients got complete pain relief? Okay, so overall patients getting pain relief, 32% versus 75%. The difference is 43%, and they've given you confidence intervals for that. Okay, here they've compared median number of days in hospital, 8 versus 11. Difference is 3, and you have a confidence interval for that. So you need to read up a little bit about confidence intervals because I won't have the time to go in more detail. But remember, what confidence intervals represent is the range of values that you can reasonably expect to find in the population. Any problem?
So this one was 0.8 to 2.
Yeah.
If it is 0.95 to 10, still that is not...
0.95 is still less than 1. The minute it's approaching 1, it will not be statistically significant. Does anybody know what a hazard ratio is? So sometimes we look at time to event data, right? Time to recurrence, time to death. This is mainly done in oncology studies where you're looking at recurrence-free survival, overall survival. And the uniqueness of this type of data is that the study will end before all the patients have experienced the outcome. So if you're looking at 5-year survival after surgery for colorectal cancer, right? At the end of 5 years, some people will still be alive. Not everybody dies. And your study has to end, right? How do you analyze those people? So you take into account that they have survived for 5 years, and then you do something called censoring. Okay? Now, survival analysis is a completely different talk by itself. But for time to event data and survival analysis, we use something called the hazard ratio. It's exactly like a relative risk, except that in relative risk, you're comparing the number of events in one group versus the number of events in the other group, right? In hazard ratio, in addition to events, you're taking time, okay? So what hazard ratio tells you is at any given point during the study, how likely is somebody in one group to experience an event? For example, if you're looking at overall survival, how likely is it that somebody in group A will die as compared to somebody in group B, okay? So take home message, hazard ratio is used for time to event data, and it looks at event rate per unit time, okay? This was a study looking at laparoscopy versus open colectomy for non-metastatic colon cancer. And you can see hazard ratios for different outcomes. So tumor recurrence hazard ratio was 0.72. The interpretation is just like relative risk. This means laparoscopy reduced the risk of recurrence by 30%. But obviously, this is not statistically significant. Why? It includes the value 1, and you can see that the p-value is not significant, right? So if you have confidence intervals, you actually don't even need to look at the p-value. Just by looking at the intervals, you'll know that this result is not statistically significant. Overall mortality, 0.77, again, not significant, right? Look at this one. Cancer-related mortality, 0.68. And look at the confidence intervals, 0.5 to 0.9. Both are on the same side of unity. So LAP reduces the risk of this event, cancer-related mortality, by as much as 50% or as little as 10%, but it definitely reduces the mortality. Quickly running through regression techniques, right? So what we do in regression is we try to look at what is the strength of association between two variables, okay? For For numerical variables, which are normally distributed, we would do something called a linear regression. But what we do more commonly is something called logistic regression. And that is done when your outcome is binary or dichotomous. For example, survival and death, complications, no complications. Okay? Just to give you an example of linear regression, this was a study which looked at radiation exposure, dose, and other factors during ERCPs. So they've done a linear regression to see whether increased procedure time is associated with increased fluoro time. Okay, logically, it does seem to be, of course it will, right? But you can see that they've managed to draw a straight line through most of their data, and they've derived a linear regression equation. Okay, you don't need to get into that. What you need to remember is linear regression is done when you're trying to look at an association between two continuous variables, which are normally distributed. Now coming to logistic regression, okay? So you want to do a study looking at factors affecting GERD, and your question is, does the use of tobacco or alcohol increase the likelihood of GERD? So you first look at smoking versus GERD, and you find an odds ratio of 1.8. So somebody who has smoked for a long time versus somebody who hasn't. The odds is 1.8. This means a smoker is 1.8 times more likely to develop GERD as compared to somebody who didn't smoke. Is that okay? Next, you did alcohol versus no alcohol. So somebody who consumed a lot of alcohol versus no alcohol, you found an odds ratio of 1.1. Okay, again, alcohol appears to increase the risk of GERD, right? Now, the problem is there are confounders over here. Smokers may be drinking more alcohol. Smokers may also be drinking more coffee. Smokers may not be exercising adequately or whatever. So the thing is, there are multiple factors at play here, and you don't know whether the results that you're seeing are because of the smoking or the alcohol or the coffee or some other factor, right? So when we do univariate regression analysis, we are able to take only one factor at a time. But you need to do something called a multivariate logistic regression, which simultaneously controls for all these factors. Okay? So your statistical software will allow you to enter multiple predictor variables, smoking, drinking, coffee, exercise, obesity, name it, and you can enter it. And your outcome is GERD versus no GERD. Okay? And then it adjusts for all these factors and gives you what we call an adjusted odds ratio or an adjusted relative risk. I think Dr. Kate referred to this during his talk. Okay, so that is what adjustment means. Adjustment for confounding variables. And the adjusted odds ratio was 1.7, which means after accounting for imbalances in alcohol intake, coffee, lack of exercise, smoking is still an independent risk factor for developing GERD, okay? And these are the actual results from the same study. You can see that in the multivariate regression model, adjustments were made for age, gender, body mass, tobacco smoking, and multiple other variables. And after that, they've given you multivariate odds ratios with the confidence intervals for each of the odds ratios. So these are the univariate, where you took one variable against the outcome, and these are the multivariable, okay? So next time you read a paper, please pay attention to the multivariable adjusted odds ratios and the confidence intervals.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah.
I have a question. In this multivariate and univariate analysis, while proceeding for multivariate, do we need to pick among the univariate variables which show significant odds ratio or all the variables?
Yeah, so that's a good question. So there are two ways of doing this. One is any variable which has a p-value of 0.1 on a or less on a univariate is included in the multivariate. In addition, any variable that you think is clinically significant, even though it may not have been significant on the univariate, can be included. But you cannot include variables which are associated with each other. So you can't put height and body surface area into a multivariate model because BSA depends on height. Okay, so if you know that two variables are already linked to each other, You can't put them both into the multivariate model. Okay? There is a technique of sample size calculation also for multivariate. So it's not that if you have a sample of 200 patients and maybe 100 of them had complications, then there is a certain number of variables that you can test using those 100 people with complications. Okay, you'll have to sit with a statistician. But the bottom line is you first do a univariate, identify variables which are significant on the univariate. Your significance need not be 0.05. You can be slightly more flexible. You can go up to 0.1. Okay. In addition, if you think a particular variable is highly clinically significant, then you can enter it. Okay. And these models work on the principle of forward and backward. Okay. So what they do is they add one variable at a time and see which model gives the best predictability. So it will add and take out, add one more, take out something else. Or it works backwards. It puts in 20 variables and slowly removes one at a time and sees which model gives you the best prediction of complications. Okay?
I mean, multivariate analysis, any odds ratio more than one is significant, or there is some criteria to say it is significant?
If the confidence intervals are on the same side of one. Only the interpretation of odds ratio is the same whether you're doing a multivariate or a univariate.
Okay.
The confidence intervals for the odds ratio should not include the value 1.
Ma'am, how to know when to use the forward module of logistic regression and when to use the backward?
You'll have to sit with the statistician. Most people tend to use the forward, but different statisticians have their own preferences. I'm not sure if there's a rule for that. So, you know, the whole thing, a lot of statisticians don't believe in logistic regression at all because it's all about statistical adjustment and it depends so heavily on the variables that you have entered into the model. Okay, but in the absence of better methods to do it, this is probably the only way you have. But yes, it's highly dependent on the data that you feed in. So if you omit a variable or if you add too many variables which dilutes the effect, you will get completely differing answers. Right? Last 10 minutes, we're just quickly going to go over a paper. And I'm going to tell you when you read a paper, what you need to look for. So this was, because I'm an anesthetist, this is the study I chose. Dexamethasone versus standard treatment for postoperative nausea and vomiting in GI surgery. It's a randomized controlled trial. Okay. So in statistics, what do you need to look for? What are the outcome measures and have they specified the primary and the secondary outcome measures clearly? Okay. And in addition to saying what is the outcome, have they specified how the outcome will be measured and analyzed? Okay, so pain, have they said it's going to be measured on a scale of 1 to 10? Nausea and vomiting, what scale are they using? Who is going to be assessing that? Okay, we spoke about blinding. Dr. Kate spoke about blinding and how it's so important, right? So something like nausea, which is a very subjective outcome, you need a blinded assessment to make sure that it's a reliable and valid assessment. Okay. So we spoke about binary and continuous outcomes, and we should talk about either proportions or rates. And to compare the two groups, they should either use a difference in proportions or talk about odds ratio or relative risk, or they could do a logistic regression, right? For continuous, they would talk about means or medians, and then they would talk about difference between means and then possibly do a linear regression. So look at what they have said. The primary outcome measure was vomiting. Now, vomiting was defined clearly as expulsion of gastric content, okay? And then it had to be noted by a staff. So they were pretty clear about what they measured. And then the secondary outcome measures included number of episodes of vomiting, and they defined it as an interval of 5 minutes defining separate episodes, okay? And so on for multiple secondary outcomes. Now, one of the criticisms of this study could be is that the number of outcomes is too many. They have one primary, but they have multiple secondary outcomes. Okay, but as long as you're not using your secondary outcomes to change practice, you're using it more as hypothesis generating results, then it's fine because studies are not powered for the secondary outcome. Okay, sample size calculation is always done based on the primary outcome. So your study may not be powered for the secondary outcome. what is the proposed statistical plan for analyzing these endpoints? So just one or two slides to show you that there are lots of tests available. Everyone's familiar with the chi-square test. Everyone's familiar with the student's t-test, right? That's the unpaired t-test. But please remember, depending on the kind of data, there are many, many other tests which are available, and your statistician is the best person to tell you what test will suit your data, okay? So for example, if you have skewed data, you shouldn't be doing a t-test. You should be doing a Mann-Whitney test. If you have four groups, you shouldn't be doing multiple t-tests. You should be doing something called the analysis of variance, ANOVA, right? Just like that for paired groups, when you have before, after readings, right? You have a paired t-test, you have a repeated measures, ANOVA, and then for categorical data, you have some tests, right? You don't need to get into the details of this, but you just need to know that depending on the type of data, you will have different types of tests. So they calculated the proportions of patients in each group experiencing a particular outcome, and they expressed that as risk ratio and number needed to treat. For the continuous data, they spoke about means and standard deviations with 95% confidence intervals, right? And they used t-tests for continuous variables and chi-square for categorical variables. So extremely clear, extremely detailed statistical analysis plan. How was the sample size calculated? Have they specified the type 1 error, the type 2 error, and the estimated treatment effect? So here the sample size was chosen to detect. Now look at this, it's a 24% proportional reduction, a relative risk reduction, okay? Which means 37 in the standard arm, and they're expecting it to be 28 in the DEXA arm, okay? And that represents a 9% reduction, which is actually a 24% proportional reduction, a 24% relative risk reduction. And they've given a reference for this. I think Dr. Kate mentioned this as well. When you're calculating sample size and you're projecting an estimate of difference between groups, you need to be sure where that difference is coming from. Is it from a pilot study that you've done, or is it from published literature? Because sample size is inversely proportional to the expected difference. So the larger the difference, the smaller is your sample size. And it's very easy for everybody to say, I expect the new treatment to reduce vomiting by 50% or 60%, and then do a study of 20 patients and finish the whole thing, right? But that doesn't work that way, because you'll end up with a negative study. So unless your difference is realistic and is based on available literature or a pilot study, you will end up with a negative study. And they've given us the other details of the sample size calculation. Now, I'm not going into details of this, but if planned, the statistical section should mention what adjustment they're going to do for imbalance in baseline characteristics, okay? Have they done any stratification, any other methods? Are they planning any subgroup analysis, any interim analysis, and any adjustments for multiple comparisons? So all of this needs to come into the statistical plan and should be pre-specified. Again, this has already been mentioned. If you're aware of this, I will not go into it. Everyone's familiar with ITT and PP? Yes, no, yes, okay, good. Okay, then in the results, so in the baseline characteristics, description of the participants and comparability between the groups, okay? So in this study, look at how it was. They've shown the detailed baseline characteristics, and most of us tend to focus only on the mean, but please remember that there is a standard deviation in brackets, and if that standard deviation is very large, it indicates a lot of variability, okay? I'm going back to this slide, and can somebody now tell me why this is wrong? Why you should not be showing a p-value for baseline characteristics? So what does a p-value tell you? Let's go back to the definition of p-value. What is the probability that the difference that you are seeing has occurred by chance? Now, in a randomized trial, you put patients into two groups. Any difference that you see has occurred by chance, right? So you don't need a p-value, okay? So anything that you feel is clinically imbalanced, okay? Clinically, you feel that these two groups are not balanced, you should tackle it statistically at the end of the study, okay? You could do it during the study by stratifying and other methods of randomization, But please remember, the p-value doesn't make any sense here, because irrespective of whether your p-value is 0.99 or 0.01, this difference has occurred only by chance if you have done a proper randomization. Okay? So, no, it wouldn't. It wouldn't. So the strict guidelines are no p-values for baseline characteristics. We assume that randomization has been done properly, and we assume that any difference that you see at baseline has occurred only by chance and should be tackled statistically at the end.
How can we say that there is a difference between the two groups?
How can you say that?
Yes, ma'am.
So if one group has 70% females and the other group has 30% females, and your outcome is post-op nausea and vomiting, now how do you know whether the difference in vomiting is because of the gender imbalance? Because females are more prone to PONV, right?
So these 30 and 70 is too much, but if there is a difference of 50 and 60,
it depends 40 and 60. On, it would depend on you. When you run a logistic regression model, it will adjust for that difference, irrespective of whether that difference is statistically significant or not. Okay? So that's the way to do it. How large was the effect of the intervention? And how precise is the, I'm going to take 5 minutes more, how precise was this effect estimate? Okay? So you look at the actual treatment effect, which means your sample statistic. In addition, you look at the p-value, which gives you the statistical significant. But please remember to look at the confidence intervals, which tell you the population estimate and how precise your estimate is. So if your confidence intervals are very wide, it means it's an imprecise estimate. And that usually happens when you have a very small sample size. Okay. So look at this study. The absolute risk reduction was 7%. So in one group, in the DEXA group, there was 25% vomiting. In the standard arm, there was 33% vomiting. They've calculated a relative risk for vomiting, which is 0.77, okay, which means DEXA in this study reduced the risk of vomiting by roughly 30% or 23%. The 95% confidence intervals were so much to so much, okay, which means there could be an 8% reduction in vomiting or a 35% reduction in vomiting, but there's definitely a reduction in vomiting. And the number needed to treat was 13. So for every 13 people treated with dexamethasone, one person would be spared from vomiting. Okay? I'm going to end by talking about this. This is statistical versus clinical significance. So statistics will throw up a lot of numbers, a lot of significant p-values. Okay? But remember, nothing matters more than whether it is significant in your practice. So this is the famous Moore paper. I don't know if any of you have read it. I assume there are no oncologists here. So this was advanced pancreatic cancer. The standard treatment was gemcitabine alone. And this group, it's a very famous Canadian trials group, they looked at erlotinib plus gemcitabine versus gemcitabine alone, right? Erlotinib is an extremely expensive drug. Can you get that out of the way, please? This is my last slide. Look at this. The hazard ratio for death was 0.82 in the erlotinib arm, which means in this study, it reduced the risk of death by 18%. Confidence intervals 0.69 to 0.99, which means it could reduce the risk of death by as little as 1% or as much as 31%. And the p-value is significant. More importantly, median survival, which means 50% of patients in the study, in this arm, the control arm, survived 5.91 months. And in the erlotinib arm, survived 6.24 months. Again, a statistically significant difference. But if you look at it, what was this difference? It was 0.33 months, which was 10 days, right? So when you're looking at the results of a study, please don't focus on the p-values. Please think about whether a survival benefit of 10 days justifies the use of an expensive and probably toxic drug. Okay? That's my last slide. I'm happy to take questions if there are any. How much time do I have? So in survival analysis, I do have one ready, but I don't think they have the time for it. Okay. So supposing you're looking at survival after colorectal cancer surgery, right? And you want to do your study for 5 years, right? Now, over the next 2 or 3 years, as people get operated, you'll start accruing them in your study, right? And then at the end of 5 years, some people would have had a 5-year follow-up, some people would have had a 2-year follow-up. The ones who came in at the end would have had a 2-year follow-up, right? Some would have died. So in the ones who have died, you know clearly that they live for so long after their surgery. And so you know the survival time. But then the ones who have not yet died, all you know is that they have lived for X amount of time after their surgery. Maybe 2 years, maybe 3 years, maybe 4 years. And then you have to end the study because you can't keep doing the study until everybody dies, right? So these are what we call censored observations. Censored just means we know until a particular point, okay, and then we don't know. Now the thing is, you can't exclude these patients from the entire study. In a typical study, you would say patients with missing data get excluded for some kinds of analysis, right? Though that is also wrong, and you should try to find ways to include them. But in survival analysis, these are the patients who are going to give you the best outcomes. They are the ones who have not died, not had the event. And this is what is known as censored data. Okay? So when you draw a Kaplan-Meier, they are represented as ticks on the Kaplan-Meier. Okay? And it just means, the slide's gone, but those ticks represent censored patients. And the downward steps represent events, meaning people who died. Did that answer your question? Sort of.
What does it signify? Like,
it signifies incomplete data because the person has not experienced the event when the study was over. It doesn't invalidate your study. It just depends on why those dashes are there. The example that I gave you of the study ending before somebody has experienced the event is one example of censoring. The other example of censoring is losses to follow up. Okay? So suppose you followed up somebody on a yearly basis. So you have data for the first year, second year, third year, and then you lose the patient to follow up, right? Now, this patient gets censored at the third year because still 3 years after surgery, you know that he was alive and then you've lost him. So it depends on the cause of censoring. Okay? If censoring is because the study has ended and you have too much of censoring, it just means that your follow-up was not long enough and you need to plan your study to include a longer follow-up so that most of your patients experience the event. And that would depend on the biology of the disease that you're studying. For example, prostate cancer, we know patients live for 10 or 20 years. So if you're going to look at 2-year data or 3-year data, you're not going to have outcomes. Lung cancer, okay, maybe, I don't know about GI cancers. You would expect a lot of events to occur in the first 4 to 5 years. So there, a 5-year follow-up is reasonable, which is why in oncology, for prostate, we usually talk about 10-year survival or 15-year survival. Whereas for other kinds of cancers, which are more aggressive, you would hear people talking about a 1-year OS or a 2-year OS or a 3-year OS. Any other questions? The ratio is constant, okay? And when you calculate the hazard ratio, so the hazard keeps changing. The hazard is the risk of death or risk of event at any given point of time. Okay? And the assumption that we make is that the hazard in the two arms is proportional. Right? So though the actual hazard is changing, the proportion remains more or less constant. And then the hazard ratio averages out a single ratio for the entire study. That may not always be. Yeah, so that may not always be true, okay? And you need to sit with a statistician and run a test of proportionality. And if your test of proportionality is not satisfied, then you cannot calculate a single hazard ratio. Okay, this is particularly true when you're comparing surgery versus medical management. Okay, so if people undergo, if people with coronary artery disease are randomized to either medical management or surgery. Surgery has immediate perioperative complications. So if you look at it, the initial hazard is very high in surgery. But if you survive that surgery, then you actually do better than somebody. So this is a case of non-proportional hazards, where initially the hazard is higher in the surgery arm, and later it's higher in the medical arm. So you can't calculate a single hazard ratio for this kind of data. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am, for this wonderful session.